Drives it in for Chara. Chara fires, score!
The sweater has changed, of course. So too have the role, the challenges, and the expectations of his new team. But there are a few things that haven't changed with Zdeno Chara. The even demeanor, the drive on the ice, and the supreme devotion to fitness off it.
I think I'm very addicted to it, and it started at a very young age with my dad. He was a professional athlete. He was a Greco-Roman wrestler. And, as a kid, he started taking me to the gyms, and being around that environment, you get used to it, and you start to liken it. And can get day without a workout. I have to have a workout or bike ride or something like that. I really enjoy it.
Now, I understand your father created a unique situation in your backyard to further your fitness, hanging ropes from trees and punching bags. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
It was, we had actually pretty big yard and a lot of trees and all those things. And it was kind of a fun activity that my dad did, kind of like a pull-up bar on the trees or a little rope or things like that, that every time I walked by, I had to do a couple pull-ups or went up and down a rope or, do push-ups or, we decided one day just dig the well. We didn't have enough water and water was really expensive, so we decided to dig a well, and we dig it for two or 3 weeks straight and with bare hands. And it was pretty hard.
Although he plays in excess of 30 minutes a night, Chara is in the gym 2, 3, sometimes 4 times a day. That, he says, is his idea of a perfect day. And when he's not in the gym, he's riding a Schwinn, another passion he developed at a young age.
My dad was actually a part-time physiotherapist, and obviously cycling was one of the sports. And he went to the races with the cyclists, and he took me to the races with him. And I was actually the guy who was standing on top of the hill and handing the water bottles to the guys. And that's really, I got really touched by that sport because it was amazing. The guys was really descending really fast, and see those faces of pain going uphill. I was really amazed by that. And then those guys I was handing the bottles to decided to make me a bike. So I got a bike as a present, and I started to ride a bike on my own. That's how it started.
You've been at the Tour de France several times, riding a bike there. When did that interest start?
As I was cycling and training, then me and my buddy from Florida, we decided to do a couple races, and actually we went to one big race in Czech Republic, and then we just talked about, to see Tour de France, and it was the most amazing time. It was such a great experience to be right there, the biggest cycling race in the world, and be able to ride the same roads and stages. It was something that I decided to do every year.
Tonight he meets his old team, the Ottawa Senators, for the first time since his somewhat cloudy free agent departure in July.
Well, I don't know what happened exactly. Some things like this happen in hockey. You have to move on. For whatever reason, we didn't reach agreement, and I went to July 1st, and there were other teams interested, and Boston was one of them, and I decided to sign with Boston because I really believe this organization wants to make it better and turn things around, and I want to be part of it. And I knew that would be a challenge, and we're going through that challenge right now, and it's a learning process. We got a lot of new faces, but that's not an excuse. But we all realize we have to do better.
There had been considerable talk about trying to keep both you and Redden in Ottawa. Would you have taken less money to stay with the Senators, or did it ever get to that point?
I don't know. I mean, it's past, and I move on. And
do you feel the Senators made a choice?
They made a decision, and I made a decision, and that's the way it is.
Through 6 NHL seasons, he's never been afraid to mix it up.
Dowell will go.
But at 28, now a center iceman for the Minnesota Wild, Jake Dowell has a terrifying secret. A secret concealed inside his own body.
This is a different kind of fear that I just, I don't really know how to handle it.
The reason Jake lives with fear rests deep within this broken man. His 59-year-old father, John.
He can't do anything else except watch TV. And he will tell me that he'll get tears in his eyes when something's going on with one of the kids. But he said, you know, I can't even cry. I can't even cry anymore.
Number 19, Jake Dowell.
This was a young Jake with his dad.
Very, very, very proud of him.
His father's voice would carry across the ice at their local rink in Eau Claire, Wisconsin, some 90 miles east of Minneapolis.
I knew if I had a bad game in hockey or he didn't think I worked hard enough, I was always asking to ride home with my mom because I didn't want to sit and hear it.
Yet Jake had his older brother, Luke, looking out for him.
He was a great athlete growing up, and obviously he was a kid that I looked up to a lot, and he was an awesome big brother.
If somebody was picking on you or giving you a hard time?
Oh, it was done. It was settled.
But as Jake and Luke grew older, there was a change in their father.
Screaming, and he would be right, he'd get in personal space, and I'm screaming at the other side, you know, it was so awful.
Luke and my dad were yelling at each other, and they were in the kitchen, and there was some shoving, and so I got in the middle of it and grabbed my dad, and we went to the ground.
What's that like to watch your husband do that to your children?
There's nothing worse. There's nothing worse.
But there was. In the fall of 2002, Jake's father's behavior grew even more erratic. His motor skills seemed to deteriorate. When the 47-year-old underwent a battery of tests, the diagnosis was Huntington's disease.
The first thing I did is go online and look it up, and I couldn't even read it because there was like three paragraphs on the disease and 10 pages on the caregiver. I couldn't even talk, I was crying so hard.
Huntington's is a fusion of dementia and ALS. It affects an estimated 30,000 people in the United States. While those with the disease can live into their 60s, it can destroy mind and body much earlier. In September of 2002, Jake was just 17 when he learned the shattering news.
I just was so mad at everything that was going on. I felt robbed of, you know, my dad, and felt like it was such a burden on my mom that I just thought everything was unfair, and I kind of went into a poor me, everybody feel bad for me, for about a year or two.
Jake's father would continue to decline. His body, his mind, his speech. He could not be there with his wife when, in 2006, Jake's Wisconsin Badgers went to the Frozen Four, and by a 2-1 score in the final, won it all.
3-2-1 shot!
He came up to me and, Mom, do you believe it? I mean, isn't this awesome? And then a local news person interviewed Jake from Eau Claire.
What do you want to say to your dad back home in Eau Claire?
Dad, I just want to say I love you, and I know you saw the game, and thanks for being there for me.
John was at home, and he said, I cried. I cried when he told me that. That meant everything in the world to me.
There he is!
On November 22nd, 2007, Jake's parents were watching from a bar in Eau Claire when their son played in his first NHL game. and scored. There would be more goals for Jake.
Dell to Dowell, he shoots, he scores!
But toughness on the ice would be his calling card.
Training.
I've gotten in fights where it's just because that's part of my job and I've had to stick up for somebody, but then there's been other times where I've legitimately been angry.
That anger off the ice would yield to uncertainty and fear, because Huntington's is genetically transmitted. Jake knows there is a 50% chance that he has the disease.
You good?
I would never not give it to my worst enemy.
But Jake's father did give it.
There he is.
To his eldest son.
Hey, Luker.
Hey. How you doing, bro?
This is Jake's older brother, Luke, now, at 30, a victim of Huntington's disease.
Luke, now we know, had early onset of Huntington's at about age 14.
It's Luke's confirmation.
At age 17, he had a mental break and became schizophrenic, which is also a symptom of the Huntington's, but we didn't know anything about this.
Early onset Huntington's is rare. What it's done to his mind requires Luke to have constant care.
It's just tough to have much of a relationship with him. He kind of goes into his head and he hears a lot of voices and he sits and kind of mumbles to them to himself. There's nothing new going on in his life from day to day. It's the same thing.
Mom said she got you using that iPod again. She showed you how to use it again, so you know how to play that music.
She looked real good.
Jake, have you been tested for Huntington's disease?
No, I haven't.
Why has not getting tested been the right decision for you so far?
I think, believe me, if I knew I would be able to handle it, I would have done it already, but I'm just scared if it's a positive test that it's gonna consume my life.
With this nasty disease, Jake and I have really gotten closer.
We've gotten closer?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We had gotten home from being out and his dad grabbed him and said, I'm so tired of being sick. And watching Jake start to see himself like that, that's the last thing that I want. I'm so scared.
In July of 2012, Jake and his longtime girlfriend Carly were married. Their decision to start a family will spur Jake to get tested at last.
I know that he feels guilty and wonders, can I bring another person into this knowing what might happen?
The only promise he made to me that I asked that he keep is that he does not bring another child into this world that may have that disease.
If I can't go out and throw baseball or football with my kid in my backyard, that's going to be something that's devastating to me, and that's definitely a scary thought.
This summer, after training for his upcoming season with the Minnesota Wild, Jake went back home to visit his father and brother.
It drains you a little bit mentally because you're thinking, you know, how much are they going to have changed? Are they going to be worse? Or what am I going to talk to them about now?
Luke.
And he reminds me of that every time I see him.
Jake's father and brother now reside in the same assisted living facility, a move necessitated by their continuing physical and mental decline.
All right, love you.
I love you too.
Love you.
Love you too.
And so someday, Jake Dowell will bring his loved ones together as he discovers whether or not he has Huntington's disease, an answer that will determine the life he will lead and the way it will end.
What would it be like to know that you didn't have Huntington's disease?
Oh, it'd be the biggest weight ever lifted off me. Whatever energy that I waste worrying about this right now, I could put into my life and helping other people.
Either can't have it, or they have to have cure in his lifetime, because I can't lose him. I just want him to have a long, long life filled with dreams coming true and lots of happiness, and I believe he deserves that. Someone in our family needs to be able to have that life.
There's a lot to like about Alexander Burmistrov of the Barry Colts. Speed, hockey sense, even a discerning taste.
I don't like ugly score. If ask what do you like better, goal and this beautiful assist, it's like a beautiful assist.
But ask an NHL general manager and he'll tell you there's one thing about Burmistrov that gives him pause.
For what we're looking for in a player, he has all the ingredients that we like. The compete, the skill, the will, the drive. It's the passport we're wondering about.
It's called the Russian factor, and it's cast a shadow over the NHL draft since 2005, the year the Russian Hockey Federation told the IIHF that it would not sign the new transfer agreement with the NHL.
Without this agreement, there's really no control. A lot of times they set their own rules, and the rules can change constantly.
Until there's some sort of agreement with the Russian Hockey Federation and the NHL, it's buyer beware. You're at risk.
NHL teams have become increasingly reluctant to take a chance on players born in Russia. Russian first-rounders have dwindled from 8 in 2000 to 1 in 2009.
These draft picks are like gold chips, and nobody wants to risk picking somebody and having them sail off in the sunset never to be seen again.
Further complicating matters is the KHL, which formed in 2008. And promptly persuaded Alexander Radulov to walk out in the final year of his contract with the Nashville Predators.
At any point in time, a Russian player can go back to the KHL and be welcomed with open arms, with no consequences, no questions asked. He get paid a lot of money.
And since the top young Russian players sign with KHL teams when they're 16, freeing them from their Russian obligations can prove tricky.
The trouble over there is, you know, they can say they got a one-year contract or two-year contract, whatever they have, and all of a sudden we'll wake up and we'll find out it was a five-year contract.
In our minds, there's only one rule, and that is that there are no rules in Russia.
As for Burmistrov, who moved to Barry from Kazan last August, he says nothing will hold him back.
I have one-year contract more with KHL team, which does not stop me. This is my hometown. All general manager, president team know me when I'm young. If this is your dream, you want to play NHL, you go, we not stop you.
What a great situation, what a statement he made. He said, I want to come over here and learn.
I like this game. I think it's more helped me than other guys who play in the KHL.
And yet one needs to look no further than Radulov, who played 3 years with Quebec in the QMJHL, to know that nothing is certain.
It's really your homework, your gut feel, a lot of praying that you make the right decision.
Nobody wants to waste any draft pick, even if it's the 150th, but certainly if you're picking, you know, in the first round, and you don't want to have a player that you're not sure is committed to playing in North America.
Scott Housen speaks from experience. Nikita Filatov, his first round pick in 2008, has taken longer than expected to develop and spent much of this past season playing in Moscow.
Nikita felt that he's going to get better in the more so in the KHL than the AHL. Whether he's right or wrong, I'm not sure, but if the player's not comfortable somewhere, then his development's going to suffer.
Time will tell how Alexander Burmistrov will handle overtures from the KHL. But at least for now, his opinion is firm.
I don't care for money now. I want to play NHL, not KHL. KHL really like for old guys, for 40 years old guys, and it's not for me.